Herkese merhaba, iyi akşamlar.
Merhabalar İsmail.
Nasılsın Levent?
Heyecanlı.
Heyecanlı şu değil anda... mi? Gerçekten çok heyecanlı.
Evet, şu anda çayımı demledim. Ve süper. Bekliyorum.
Bugün kahve yok, çay var.
Kahveler içildi bugün, artık yeter fazlası.
Doğru. Yayına gelen herkese teşekkür ederiz. İstiyorsan açılışı ben yapayım.
Tabii, güzel olur.
Senden en azından bir yük almış olayım. Kalması yayınına hoş geldiniz. Bugün özel bir yayınımız olacak. Konuğumuz Scott Rao. Kahve masasında ben İsmail Gökçen.
Ben Levent Öncü.
Hepiniz hoş geldiniz tekrardan yayınımıza ve konuklarımız da gelmeye başladı. Çok teşekkür ederiz geldiğiniz için. Gerçekten bizim için de çok heyecanlı bir gün.
Evet.
Bugün özel bir yayınımız var. Normalde bildiğiniz gibi her perşembe saat 21'de Kahve Masası programında burada Instagram yayında oluyoruz. Daha sonra da Kahve Masası YouTube kanalında yayınlarımızı yayınlıyoruz. Çok heyecanlıyız. Levent bugün programı gerçekleştirecek. Scott Rao'yla bakalım sorulara nasıl cevap verecek, nelerle konuşacağız. Bunları da merak ediyorum. Levent, sen biraz bahsetmek ister misin?
Ya tabii, yani aslında biraz hani bu yayın üzerinde belki bahsetmek lazım. Hani herkes de merak ediyor olabilir. Yani biz işte en son aslında Box Cafe ile yaptığımız yayından sonra da biraz aklımıza geldi. Şimdi onlar yurt dışına açılıyor. Neden biz de kahve masası olarak yurt dışına açılmayalım dedik İsmail'le beraber. Bir şansımızı denedik. Scott Rao'ya yazdık. O da sağ olsun bize dönüş yaptı. Ondan sonra biraz konuştuk, yazışmalarımız oldu. Nasıl bir yayın olacak, nedir, ne değildir. Tabii biz İsmail'i şoku atlatamadık ilk başta. Bak Scott, evet dedi. diye. Sonradan evet dedi de şimdi ne yapacağız, yapabilir miyiz diye. Tabii çok fazla stres de oldu, panik de oldu bizde. Ondan sonra işte anlaştık, konuştuk, sorularımızı topladık. Umarım keyifli bir yayın olacak. Yayını İngilizce olarak yapacağız. Yani umarım heyecana çok yenik düşmeyiz. İngilizce olarak yapmaya çalışacağız. Amacımız da hani olabildiğince çok soru sorup daha sonradan bu yayını YouTube'a atmak ve orada da Türkçe olarak altyazıyla paylaşmak. Evet. Amacımız olabildiğince soru sormak. Şu anda bir yandan da bir şeyler geliyor, istekler, onlara bakıyorum. Tamam. Çünkü demin Scott Rao'yla da yazıştım. O şu anda Los Angeles'ta, 11 saat saat farkı var aramızda. O yüzden bir an İsmail'le de şey birbirimize baktık. Scott Rao uyandı mı acaba, gelecek mi gelmeyecek mi diye. Bir stres olduk. O da şimdi yazmış. Evet, yayına katılacak. Bir aksilik yok şu anda.
Süper. Vallahi çok heyecanlıyız. Yani gerçekten ilk duyurduğumuz andan itibaren inanılmaz olumlu dönüşler. İnanılmaz destek mesajları geldi. Çok teşekkür ederiz. Yani
çok
ilginize, alakanıza, desteğinize, sorularınıza gerçekten bizler için de çok özel bir yayın olacak. Kahve masası çok değerli, çok önemli bir konu ağırlıyor. Bakalım, yani merakla bekliyorum ben. Söyleyeceğimi demiyorum Levent. Gerçekten çok güzel bir yayın olacak. Tabii ki bizleri destekleyebilirsiniz. Bunun için yapmanız gereken ise Kahve Masası YouTube kanalımıza destek olabilirsiniz. Abone olarak destek olabilirsiniz. Yine Instagram üzerinden bizleri takip evet. ederek bizlere destek olabilirsiniz. Bunlar bizim için değerli, kıymetli.
Evet, en azından yaptığımız şeyler için bizi de motive eden şeyler. Biliyorsunuz zaten hani bizim İsmail'e bu bir hobimiz. Hobimizi biraz evet. daha hani farklı bir boyutta yapmaya çalışıyoruz. Ve işte herkese faydalı olacak bir şeyler yapmaya çalışıyoruz burada. O yüzden bakarsanız belki ileride daha farklı sürpriz konuklar da gelebilir. Yani sizin destekleriniz bizim için önemli. Ve destekleriniz de gerçekten bizim için bir motivasyon kaynağı. Çok teşekkür ediyoruz hepinize. Tansel hoş geldin bu arada. Türker hoş geldin.
Hoş geldiniz. Hepiniz hoş geldiniz yayına. Yani bu noktada şunu da söylememiz gerekiyor. Sizlerden gelen bizlere geri dönüşlerle, sorularla ve hani yaptığınız taleplerle birlikte biz de konuklarımızı bu noktada davet ediyoruz. Özellikle mesela şimdi adını vermeyeceğim ama yılbaşının ilk haftası eğitimlerle ilgili çok sorular geldi. Kahve eğitim, barista eğitimleriyle ilgili çok önemli, evet. güzel sorular geldi. Bunlarla ilgili çok değerli bir konuğumuz olacak yine Türkiye'den. Kendilerini ağırlayacağız ve siz merak ettiğiniz ev baristaların hem de normal baristaların çok merak ettiği hı hı. bütün soruları da burada cevaplamış ve yanıtlamış olacağız. Bu konuda hani sizlerde bize önerileriniz varsa iletebilirsiniz. Tabii ki herkes Hoffman'ı yazıyor. Umarım ileride o da olur. Scott Rao ile başlıyoruz. Gerçekten çok özel bir konuk bizim için. Hani kabul ettiği için de buradan hani ne kadar neler söylesek azdır. Çok teşekkür ederiz. Sonuç olarak bizler de bildiğiniz gibi biraz ev demleyicisiyiz ve Devent'in de eklediği gibi ev baristasıyız ve bunları amatörce yapıyoruz aslında. Hani bizler evet. merak ediyorduk. Hani kahve ile ilgili tecrübelerimizi nasıl paylaşırız, neler yaparız diye işte bir program sonrası gelen tepkilerle buralara kadar geldik. Gerçekten heyecanlıyız, mutluyuz.
Evet, gerçekten. Yani dediğimiz gibi Scatola'nın geleceğini duyunca biz zaten çok sevindik, heyecanlandık. Hala da heyecanlıyız. Belki belli oluyordur. böyle bir şey, bir yandan da böyle şimdi sorumluluk falan oldu. Çünkü o kadar çok güzel soru geldi ki. Hani hem kavurucularımızdan hem de ev baristası arkadaşlarımızdan çok güzel sorular da geldi. Destekler de geldi. O yüzden şu anda yani tek amacımız bu yayını böyle alnımızın akıyla yapıp bitirmek. Belki bu sayede ileride daha güzel de konuklarımız olabilir. Yine kahve dünyasından çok tanınan konuklarımızı yayına alma şansımız olabilir.
Gerçekten öyle. Bu noktada şunu da değinmek istiyorum. Yani özellikle çok fazla teknik soru geldi. Bunu da belirtmek istedim. Evet. Yani hani kavurma ile ilgili çok fazla teknik soru geldi. Ama bildiğiniz gibi yani bir yandan tabii ki bunları iletmek isteriz. Ama şunu da konuşmamız lazım ki bizler ev demleyici olarak hani bu şekilde bir yayın. Hani ev demleyicileri üzerine daha çok demleme ve biraz daha hani kavurma tekniği değil de normal demleme teknikleri üzerine birkaç sorumuz var. yani özel sorularımız var. Bunu da belirtmek istiyorum. Çünkü kavurmanın içine girdiğimiz zaman bambaşka bir alem. Bildiğiniz gibi hani buna da çok biz ev demleyici olarak çok vakıf değiliz açıkçası. Bu nedenle biraz daha sorularımız ev baristalarının işte su hatta, olsun, demleme olsun, ekipmanlar üzerinden gidecek. Bunu da belirtmek isterim.
Yani hatta yani şu anda biz İsmail'le hani 20-21 tane soru hazırladık. Hani sorularımız da tabii Türkiye ile alakalı sorular var. Türk kahvesi sorusu var. O kesinlikle var. Yine işte ProVur demleme ile alakalı sorularımız var. Tabii ki de çok merak edilen raw spin'i soracağız. Nasıl, nedir, ne değildir. Bunun dışında yine tabii ki kalite ve 60 farklarını soracağız. Suyla ilgili birkaç sorumuz olacak. Yani kullanılan su, bu da çok önemli. Espresso tekniğiyle ilgili kendisinin kullandığı çift filtreli bir espresso tekniği var. Onunla ilgili bir soru soracağız. Kavurmayla ve tadımla ilgili de birkaç tane sorumuz var ama İsmail'in de dediği gibi biz profesyonel değiliz. Yani kavurucu arkadaşlardan aslında çok güzel sorular geldi. Fakat bu biraz da Scott'ın danışmanlık alanına girdiği için yani tüm soruları hem sormak istemedik hem de teknik detaylara boğmak istemedik. Yani ev kullanıcıları için çok faydalı bir şey olmayacaktı o zaman. Yani birkaç tane soruyu sormaya çalışacağız yine kavurma ile ilgili. Bunun dışında yine kahve çekirdekleri ile ilgili sorular var. Immersion tekniği var. İşte kahve nasıl saklanır? Yine yazmışlar zaten. İşte COVID-19 soruları. Bu tarz şeylerle de umarım yayını bitirmeye çalışacağız.
Yani heyecanımız yansıyor. Ben sana şunu söyleyeyim. Biraz kahve masası modülüne geri dönelim. Bence çok böyle heyecanlanıyor. O kadar resmi böyle şey oldu ki. Şeyi söyleyeyim. Evet, şey evet. Var mı abi mesela sorularda? Hani en çok bana yazılan şeylerden bir. Abi bu old crop'lar, kahveler, çekirdekler, yeşil çekirdekler en iyi nasıl kavrulur? Bu var değil mi? Bu varsa tamam abi. Yani zaten en çok merak edilen bu. Hani raw spin zaten yani Scott Rye'ı bizi tabii ki hani her baristanın hani şey ev demleyicisinin başladığı andan itibaren adını ilk duyduğu hani round'un adını ilk duyduğu şeydir, evet. Yöntemdir o ve ondan sonra zaten çok fazla böyle hani daha popüler bizim için bizim kendi şeyimizde falan yoksa kavurucular veya bu şeyi çok daha profesyonel yapan insanlar herkes tanıyor zaten. Vallahi biraz şöyle stresi atmaya yavaş yavaş başladık. Rav'da bir 4-5
sen başladın da ben bilmiyorum İsmail. Şu anda stres böyle şey yüzümden okunuyor. Cicilerimi de giydim hemen.
Yani gerçekten çok heyecanlı. Süper program olacak. Aşağıya gelen herkese teşekkür ederiz. Kahve masası yani gerçekten çok böyle bugün keyifli, mutlu bir gün. Yani 2020'nin böyle hani
fili sezon finali. Aslında.
Gerçekten sezon finali gibi. 2020 gerçekten hepimiz için, tüm Türkiye için, tüm dünya için aslında selam çok Tuğçe. Zor geçti. Bu noktada biz de artık bir böyle bir hediye olsun dedik ve Levent gerçekten bize, hepimize çok güzel bir hediye hazırladı.
Evet, bu zamana kadar bunları Orkun yapıyordu.
Evet.
Tüm Vendor'u vesaire yani tabii bayağı yapıyordu. Hani onu da heyecanlı görüyordum bazı yayınlarda. Hani gerçekten de heyecan oluyormuş. Orkun şu an sana hak veriyorum. Ki daha başlamadık bile biz.
Aynen öyle. Yani gerçekten bu noktada hani her söyleyeceğine, Scout'un her söyleyeceğine can kulağıyla dinleyeceğiz. Yani neler öğrenebiliriz, neler yapabiliriz diye de bir hani seminer gibi de olacak bizim için. Ve diğer bir şey de benim için en önemlisi, daha bundan sonra artık belki bundan bir sene sonra bile şu yayını izlerken yeni başlayan ev demleyicileri belki çok önemli bir isimle Türkçe bir kaynak bulacak. Yani aslında Türkçe derken Türkçe altyazılı, İngilizce yapılmış, Türklerin yaptığı bir altyazı, Türkçe altyazılı bir yayın yapılmış olacak. Bu da benim için çok değerli. Çünkü aynı zamanda bir arşiv niteliğindeyiz biz. Biz sizlere burada hani YouTube kanalımıza abone olun derken aslında söylediğimiz sürü dediğimiz gibi hani bizi motive eden, daha çok kaynak yaratmamızı böyle teşvik eden şeyler. Yoksa bundan tabii ki hepinizin bildiği gibi hani bir maddi bir şey getirebilecek bir noktada değil. Yani YouTube'un algoritmasını hepimiz biliyoruz. Bizler daha çok kişiye ulaşmak istiyoruz, daha çok paylaşmak istiyoruz, daha çok kahve içmek istiyoruz, daha çok öğrenmek istiyoruz. Bu da sizin bizi desteklemeniz. Bunda da destek olursanız çok seviniriz. Çok teşekkür ederiz. Gerçekten harika.
Bir de İsmail'in dediği gibi yani bunu sektörden de bazı profesyonellerden hani bize dönüş oldu. Yani hem barista arkadaşlarımızın bir kısmı İngilizce bilmiyor, hem de yani kaynakların çoğu İngilizce olduğu için. Hani bu sorduğumuz soruların çoğunun cevabını belki bir kısmını biliyorsunuz. Farklı farklı videolarda izlediniz, gördünüz. Ama buradaki amaç aslında hani sorabilirsek tüm soruları sorup hani tek bir videoda merak edilen her şeyi kayıt altına almak. Ve ardından da yine YouTube'a Türkçe altyazısıyla beraber işte soru soru atmak. Ve bu sayede de en azından yeni başlayanlar için ya da kahveye merak duyanlar için bir kaynak oluşturmak. Umarım bunda da başarılı oluruz İsmail. Orijinalini kesinlikle hemen öyle YouTube'a atarız. Tabii ama ki Türkçe çevirisi birazcık sürebilir. Destek olmayan da evet bakıyoruz. Türkçe altyazı işinde yolunuz açık olsun.
Onu yaparız evet, ya. Yani
desteklerinizi olmaz. Bekliyoruz.
Desteklerinizi
böyle böyle.
Bu arada yazıyorlar mesela. Şimdi Türker Hocam yazdı. Çok sağ olsun. Burada yayında aynı zamanda. Hocam espriler yumuşatıyorsunuz. Alnınızın akıyla çıkacaksınız bu işten. Eminiz demiş. Çok teşekkür ederiz. Ya harikasınız. Sizler bize bu enerjiyi verdiğiniz sürece biz Allah'ın izniyle hepsinin altından halka izliyorum ben.
Şey bana bir prompter lazım İsmail. Keşke bir prompter olsaydı. Şuradan şöyle koyup da rahat rahat göz yazısında okusaydık.
Evet, o da öyle bir şey de olabilirdi. İleriki yayınlarda Burak yazmış arkadaşım. Çok sağ olun. Teşekkür ederim Burak'cığım. Yani bizim için çok önemli. Gerçekten çok değerli bir konu. Levent şey var mı ya? Ben merak ediyorum. Mesela Scott Rao böyle bir Rao'da diyoruz ama Scott Rao şimdi normalde demlerken acaba şeyi hangisini kullanıyor? V60'ını kullanıyor? Kaliteleri mi kullanıyor?
İsmail bu arada gelmiş sanırım mi? Scott şu anda evet istek yolladı, onu alıyorum artık.
Tamam ben gidiyorum, hadi görüşürüz.
Tamam hadi görüşürüz.
Hadi bay bay.
Hello Scott, good morning.
Hey, good morning, how are you?
I'm fine, you?
Good, you hear me okay?
Yeah, I hear you okay. How about wonderful you?
Yes, perfect.
Okay, so hello everyone, welcome back to another episode of Cafe Masası. We have a very special guest today. I want to introduce you one of the world's most influential coffee professionals. Some of you may already know him from his scientific and systematic approach to coffee, and some of you are about to know him. So he is a coffee professional, a consultant, an author for several books, Mr. Scott Rao.
Oh, thanks for having
welcome,
me.
Welcome, Scott.
Very nice to be here.
Yeah. It's great to have you here too. So, I mean, we are very excited to have you here, Scott. So, I mean, to be honest, I didn't expect that you will accept our offer. So, we are really very happy and very excited to have you here. It's a great honor for us. It will be a great session for us tonight. So, I mean, for those that do not know you, I mean, if any, so how do you describe yourself to the average coffee drinkers? So who is Scott Rao?
Sure. So I've been in the coffee business a little bit over 25 years. In my 20s, I owned a couple of cafes and roasteries. In my 30s, I shifted from owning cafes to writing books, and then began doing consulting after people read my books and asked for help. And these days, I have a lot of projects, but I mostly do consulting for roasters, and I still do some writing. And, you know, my job is a little bit weird because I do a lot of different little things to keep it interesting. Yes. But my real goal is just to try to help people make better coffee. And it's not about, say, telling people, you know, roast lighter, roast darker, do this, do that. It's more like giving people systems and tools to hopefully take better control of their coffee and meet their goals.
Yeah, that's great, Scott. And I mean, as I mentioned, we know you from your systematic approach to coffee, and it really helps. I mean, you try to put everything in a systematic scheme, and you know, it applies for everyone. So we, you know, gathered some questions for you, and I already shared some of them with you. So first question is, I mean, it's typical because now you are guest now for the Turkey. And do you know any roasters or baristas from Turkey?
A little bit. I did a class in Turkey. Oh boy, 4 years ago maybe. I don't know. Time flies.
2016.
Oh, 2016. Yeah. So okay. So yeah, and I met some roasters there and went to a few cafes there. But I don't pretend to know a lot about the Turkish coffee scene. And I'm sure in the last 4 years there's probably a lot of new things happening because
exactly
changing so much in that part of the world. You know. So
yeah, exactly. So I mean, the second question will be actually very generic for you. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I mean, when to spin the slurry, you know, AKA rail spin.
Okay.
So, I mean, because people are curious, you know, when to do that move. I mean, just after blooming or during blooming or between the pulses. I mean, what's the best timing to do it for better extraction without causing any astringency? How long?
Sure. So I want to be honest up first and say, you know, I did not invent the spin.
Yeah.
I never claimed to invent it, but for some reason my name is on it, and I don't know why. But it's funny because I walked into a cafe in Italy, and my friend says, oh, look. And he does the spin, and I said, what are you doing? And he's like, it's yours. And I said, what do you mean it's mine? He says, it's the Rayo spin. And I said, it's not. anyway. The spin is useful because it can break up channels, right? So when you're making a pour over, probably the worst thing is to create channels because the liquid will find the path of least resistance through the coffee bed, which is a channel, and then it'll create astringency and some weakness and bitterness and such that. So let's say you were doing a pour over where you do a pre-wet and then a bloom, and then let's say you do two more pouring phases, for instance. Probably the most important time to do the spin is after the last pour. There's definitely, you know, because you have 1 or 2 minutes after the last pour when the water is just going to drain. And it's so important that the water drains evenly through the coffee bed or else, you know, if you have any kind of channeling, then you're going to get a lot of astringency. Now, after the pre-wet and just as the bloom begins, you can spin then. You could also use like a very thin implement, like a chopstick or like the back of a spoon or something. And you can just sort of, you know, do a little bit of excavation, like just breaking up the dry areas where you see, bubbles coming up.
Bubbles.
Or you could spin. Now the spin is like a kind of like a lazy way to do the bloom because you don't need to grab a spoon. You don't need anything. It helps a little bit to spin. It's probably a little bit better to stir. You just have to be careful not to kind of push the coffee into piles. You don't want to make the coffee bed uneven. But and it's optional to me whether you spin after the middle pour. Okay, so you have your pre-wed, your first pour, your second pour. The good thing about the spin is that it fixes channels. The bad thing about the spin is that it seems to cause fine particles to clog the filter pores. So if you spin too often or if you spin too aggressively, you'll clog the filter more and then you will slow down the flow. So like usually I will spin or excavate after the pre-wet. I will always spin after the last pour. Usually I won't spin after the middle pour. Sometimes I will if I think maybe I didn't do a very good job in pouring. you know, you just want to be careful to like for me, like if I were to take my travel mug, like this is to me, the spin is like, that's it. Like just a little shimmy, just enough to break up the channels, but you don't want to do this a lot because then you'll get a lot of clogging of the filter. And then what happens is the flow gets really slow. That in and of itself can cause channeling, but also it may force you to grind coarser and you lose some extraction.
Yeah, thank you. Actually, you also answered the question. I mean, I had another one, like, how is it different than stirring with a spoon or a stick? You know, so...
Yeah, so I didn't know the answer to that for a long time, but I have a friend you may be familiar with named Jonathan Gagné.
Yeah,
He's amazing. If folks amazing. Who are watching this, you should watch his Instagram. It's J Gagné Astro Coffee. I think I got that right. He has a blog called Coffee Ad Astra, and he's really, like, by far the best scientist in the world who is interested in coffee. He's amazing. Yeah. And so I posed this question to him a couple of years ago, and I said, why is it different? Why does the spin work better than stirring? Mm-hmm. And it seems that he explained it. I didn't understand it completely, but it seems like the spin will sort of preserve the relative positions of the particles within the mm-hmm. coffee bed, but the stirring can sort of shift the concentration of particles maybe mm-hmm. a little bit too much if you're not careful. So the spin seems to keep everything a little bit more uniform. We know that the spin is a little bit better in terms of fixing channels.
Okay, that's a great answer, actually. You know, that explains everything. By the way, I mean, for those who do not know, Jonathan Gagne, Scott Rao, and him had a really good IGTV chat.
Oh, yeah.
So you can also see it on Scott's Instagram page. I mean, it's really wonderful, awesome chat. Yeah. So, next question. So, we know that you have an old recipe and a new recipe for the V60 pour. So, I mean, what's your starting V60 recipe and how do you adjust it based on coffee's roast level or process type? You know, how do you start?
Sure. I think this is really important, is how do you construct a recipe and how do you adjust it, right?
Yeah.
And, so number one, how much pouring I do has a lot to do with the size of the brew. So in other words, I never do, say, like a 15-gram V60. I always make a little mm-hmm. bit more than that. But if I were to only do a 15-gram, I might only do like a pre-wet mm-hmm. and then one pour. But mm-hmm. let's say you were doing like a very large brew, like larger than 25 grams, you would definitely mm-hmm. need at least a pre-wet plus two pours. You don't want to go too high in the brewer because, and actually I've learned this through talking to Jonathan over time and his experiments, but you get more what we call bypass water if mm-hmm. if you let the slurry get much too high in the filter. And that mm-hmm. means that some water will go around the coffee bed and out the filter. Yep. So we want to, a high slurry is good in that it creates a little bit more pressure to force the water down through the grounds, which is great. Mm-hmm. But a high slurry can cause more bypass, which we don't really want. Bypass doesn't ruin flavor. It doesn't cause channels, but it does make your coffee weaker. Right. Mm-hmm. So you want a happy balance, right? And if you, like I used to do V60s with just a pre-wet plus one pour, and yes. I did that because there's a trade-off, right? The fewer pours you do and the more water each pour, the hotter the slurry is going to be overall. Mm-hmm. And probably the biggest difficulty in making pour-overs is simply that they're not that hot, right? Like even if you're using water that's nearly boiling, the slurry mm-hmm. temperature is actually like, you know, 10, 15 6, 7 C degrees, lower than that. Yeah. And it's very difficult, right? Because like, you know, maybe your kettle is 98, but then maybe mm-hmm. the water hitting the slurry is like 92 or 93. And then the actual slurry temperature is like 88 or 85, right? Or even lower depending on what you are. So, you know, this preserving heat is critical. So I used to use just one pour because I was always concerned about the heat. If you break it up into a pre-wet plus, say, two pours, you lose some heat and you gain a little bit of extraction. And you gain a little extraction partly because you have less bypass. Mm-hmm. So it's a trade-off. And I don't necessarily think one is completely right and one is completely wrong. Mm-hmm. But again, depending on the size of your brew, you might consider doing one pour or two pours. I don't like it when baristas do like four or five pours because mm-hmm. they do get a little bit more extraction, but they definitely never get up to what I consider the temperature needed to create like a really mm-hmm. nice crisp acidity. Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, when you're talking about different coffees, different processes, all these things, I don't want people to get lost in all of those details because I don't mm-hmm. think they're what matters. I think what matters most, and I'm not saying this is everything, but it's most, is think of the physics of the extraction, right? Avoid channeling, get a high extraction at a reasonable temperature. Like accomplish that and don't worry too much about, oh, what coffee is this? What processing is this? Because ultimately, you know, all we can really do as baristas is control the process so that we get a relatively high, even extraction as much as possible. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you can let your taste guide you within a certain, you know, small window where you say, you know, I like this coffee a little bit better at a slightly coarser grind setting or something like that. But if you have a good recipe, you should be able to use that recipe for all coffees and pretty much only change the grind setting. So mm-hmm. I don't see much reason to say change the dose based on the coffee. I don't see much reason mm-hmm. to change the temperature based on the coffee. Now, there's one caveat there, which is that if you are using like a bad roast, if you're using, say, mm-hmm. an underdeveloped roast or like a roasted
baked,
right? All of those things can taste quite bad, and you might intentionally extract less or use a lower mm-hmm. temperature to hide some of the roast defect. And that's very mm-hmm. subjective, and that's very, you know, I don't talk about those too much because I kind of assume that you're using mm-hmm. a good coffee. If you have a baked coffee or an underdeveloped coffee, you know, it becomes a very complicated thing. It's like, how do I fix this? There's only so much you can do. But in those cases, if you're confident that you have those problems, in those cases, you should try extracting a little bit lower and or mm-hmm. using a little bit lower temperature.
So unless we are brewing your sample set, I mean, defective sample set, right? I mean, right. You sent to people.
Roast defect kit, right?
Yeah,
right.
Yeah. I mean, unless we are brewing that one, so we don't need to worry about much what the roast level is, what the process type is. So that's good. I mean, so the key is to keep the slurry temperature as high as possible without losing much heat from the slurry. So that's good. Yeah, Thanks so much.
Okay.
So next question about, again, pour over. So it's about the blooming phase. I mean, we all know it's critical. So what's the impact of blooming phase on the total extraction yield? And mm-hmm. what's the difference between using 2x, 3x, or 4x of water during blooming? Okay. Have you had such experiment, or maybe Jonathan?
Yes, yes. That's a great question. So the reason that we're usually using 2x or 3x is that on average, coffee grounds mm-hmm. can hold twice their weight in water. So our goal with the bloom is multifaceted, right? One is that we want the water to find its way into the deepest crevices of the coffee mm-hmm. grounds, right? Because there's some like tiny grounds like fines that have no cells. And then there's grounds that are larger that have lots of cells. And we want to give the mm-hmm. water a chance to get into all of those cells and to begin dissolving things. Because mm-hmm. if you don't give it that chance, you'll end up under extracting from the centers of the cells, and you'll miss out on mm-hmm. a lot of flavor and a lot of evenness of extraction. Okay. Mm-hmm. So if no liquid were to leave the coffee bed during the bloom, then 2:1 would be plenty because that would be the saturation point for the coffee. But as you know, when you're doing the pre-wet and the bloom, there's always mm-hmm. some liquid that goes through the coffee bed and leaves the filter. So 3:1 is probably like a safe level to make sure that you can saturate the grounds. If you only use 2:1 water and some water leaves the bed, you mm-hmm. might not really get saturation. Okay, so mm-hmm. that's number one. Number two, what's happening during the bloom is that through capillary action, the liquid is mm-hmm. able to get to all the different areas of the coffee bed and hopefully get into the deepest part of the coffee grounds. Mm-hmm. Also, there's a little bit of I'll skip that. I'll just say, you know, if you can, okay. if you can accomplish that with the bloom, then you're going to get a more even extraction. Mm-hmm. Now, you might say, well, why wouldn't I bloom for like 2 minutes just to be safe? I mean, of course, you lose some temperature, but and sometimes that can work. But you'll find, interestingly enough, that the longer you bloom for, the slower the rest of the brew flows. So if this is a good experiment to do. If you do like a 40-second mm-hmm. bloom on one brew and then do everything the same but do a 2-minute bloom on the next brew, mm-hmm. you'll find that that 2-minute bloom didn't just take an extra minute 20 seconds. It took like an extra 2 minutes total or something like that. It slows down the flow of the rest of the brew. So that's not necessarily a bad thing, but it does kind of force you to perhaps use a coarser grind, which could mm-hmm. decrease the extraction. But it's, you know, it's a tool that you could adjust mm-hmm. the bloom length if you feel like you're not getting as much evenness as you want. And maybe, like I was just talking to Jonathan this morning because I'm using some brewers that brew very fast. And mm-hmm. they're forcing me to use, not really forcing, but they're causing me to use a very fine grind. And I'm finding that I'm not enjoying the flavor of the coffee with such a fine grind. And mm-hmm. now I'm thinking this morning, like, what if I use a coarser grind, but what if I bloom longer in this particular situation as a way of getting the more even extraction and not being mm-hmm. forced to grind finer. So, you know, it's a tool. Anyway, okay, so I'm going off on a tangent there. So let's move. Let's go back, okay. Back on track. Okay.
No problem. So actually, I mean, you also know, I mean, Herio has a immersion switch dripper.
Right.
So, I mean, sometimes, you know, we just, I mean, some of my friends from baristas just use, you know, immersion switch during blooming with the switch closed. Right. So we right. ensure that, you know, there is no channeling and all the particles get wet, mm-hmm. you know, evenly. Then we just open the switch and, you know, brew just like the regular V60. Do you ever use such technique?
I have. I mean, I've been trying those things for like 20 years, you know.
Yeah.
It's okay. Jonathan would be a better person to ask about this, but mm-hmm. I don't think either one of us think that the quality of the blooming is quite as good when you trap the water mm-hmm. in there. And it might be due to this. And I could be wrong about this, but I think when you close the switch and you use, say, a 2-to-1, that yep. you get such a concentrated slurry because you're mm-hmm. not removing any solids. That yep. that maybe you slow down the migration of solids into the liquid a little bit, and mm-hmm. it's not a terrible thing, but it doesn't seem to be quite as effective as using mm-hmm. like an open brewing system with a little bit more water. But okay. it's also pretty safe because, like you're saying, like you okay. can sort of prevent the channeling and you can kind of just let it
exactly.
sit there. And it certainly you know, especially if like someone's using too coarse of a grind or something like that, like it's mm-hmm. it's not a bad system. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. So, I mean, the next question is about the filter papers. So, okay. you know, I mean, now we have a lot of options in the market. Mm-hmm. And I mean, actually, I am confused. And this is becoming more and
Me
more
too.
Confusing. And because they have become a parameter in the brewing, you know,
yeah.
I mean, depending on which filter you use, I mean, you need to change the recipe. So, I mean, I am confused anyways. So what do you think about these, you know, paper filters? I mean, how do they, sure. what are their role in the brewing now?
Sure. It is confusing. You're not alone. Basically, like a good filter will have the right thickness, and it'll have a relatively even amount, even sized pores, holes, right? Mm-hmm. And if you look at the filters under a microscope, you'll see a lot of variability filter to filter. Mm-hmm. Some of them are thinner, some of them are thicker, some of them have even holes, some have wildly different hole sizes. So you don't want a filter with very different hole sizes because those can create a little bit of like micro channeling because they'll be
yep.
easier areas for the water to get through. And believe it or not, a thicker filter can sometimes enhance flow, mm-hmm. which sounds counterintuitive, but it can because it has more material to trap fine particles. Whereas
yep.
a very thin filter Reasonable. Might get clogged more easily because it doesn't have as much space to trap fines. So, mm-hmm. but practically speaking, without using a microscope and without analyzing all the filters, you have a trade-off. If you use a filter like, say, the Sybarist, which
yep.
is a new, like, very fast
flow.
Filter, you'll get very fast flow, but you will get more fines and colloids in the brew, and
mm-hmm.
that will make a cloudier, less clear flavor,
mm-hmm.
okay? And you'll get more body, of course. So you have this always, in coffee, you always have a trade-off between body and flavor clarity.
Mm-hmm.
And this shifts you very close to, you know, the extreme of more body at the expense of flavor clarity,
mm-hmm.
right? And then you have filters that are very restrictive that will give you more flavor clarity, but you lose a lot of body and you might lose some flow. Mm-hmm. So generally speaking, I would use a filter that gives you like a pretty good happy medium that you're happy with for flavor clarity
mm-hmm.
versus body. I would only use something like the Sybarist for something like, say, let's say you're brewing decaf. And decaf
mm-hmm.
has a lot of fine particles, and you might find it's very difficult to brew decaf at a good extraction level without clogging. And so
mm-hmm.
the Sybarist will often help you decrease clogging. So that would be an example of why you might want to use more than one kind of filter. But
so
unless
you know why to use it, I mean when to use it, it's better to go with the traditional ones, right?
Generally speaking, like I'm happy with the, say, like the Tabless Hario filters. I'm happy with the Kalita
yep.
filters. I'm happy with the Espro filters. They're all pretty reasonable and pretty similar.
Mm-hmm.
And then I would use the Sybarist, like if, for instance, I was using a V60 and I had like a decaf and it was very difficult
mm-hmm.
to prevent clogging, I might use the Sybarist for that. And I would
mm-hmm.
sacrifice some of the flavor clarity to prevent clogging. Because
mm-hmm.
clogging is very bad because
exactly.
you will end up with channeling. Due to the clogging, like some areas of the coffee bed will clog and then the water will find its way through other areas. And that's like the same as channeling. And
mm-hmm.
so Clogging is like death to flavor quality and brew quality, right? So if mm-hmm. you're stuck in a situation where you either have to grind extremely coarse or suffer through clogging, then the Sybaris might be a tool for you. But with most systems, like the standard filters work pretty good. So
yep.
Yeah.
Yep. Thank you. But it's confusing.
Okay. It is. So I should stop and say that you probably know from the Instagram chat that Jonathan has a book coming out
yes.
called The Physics of Filter Coffee. And mm-hmm. I helped him with publishing it, like, you know, putting it through the whole book design thing and all that, because, you know, mm-hmm. he's a busy guy. And
yes.
he has like an entire chapter describing filters and his experiments with them and analyzing the mm-hmm. pores and all that. And it's like, it's a great education, like things like that. You know, finally mm-hmm. we have the opportunity to have like objective facts rather than just, you know, you and yeah. me talking about our experiences.
Yeah, so, that would be great.
Yeah, the discussions will change a lot soon.
Yep. So another question, I think this is another famous question. I mean, Kalita. So you seem to prefer Kalita more than V60 recently. At least that's what we saw in your posts. So, I mean, how do you decide whether to use V60 or Kalita with a coffee? I mean,
okay. So I always worry about this. People make a lot of assumptions based on what they see me using in my posts. Like, oh, you're using this grinder. Oh, you're, and I don't want that. Like, I change it up sometimes just to prevent people from mm-hmm. thinking that way. So the Kalita is good, but some of the Kalitas, like the metal ones, I haven't used mm-hmm. all the different Kalitas, but some of them, like the metal ones, have a very bad hole configuration at the bottom, and mm-hmm. they can really restrict flow by letting the filter sag and mm-hmm. block the holes, right? So I've only really started using a Kalita more once I realized that I could put like a little mesh screen at the bottom, and I put mm-hmm. this on my Instagram several months ago because yep. that gives you more flow area at the bottom and prevents this restriction due to the filter clogging the holes. Mm-hmm. And like I often use the Stag brewer from Fellow, but mm-hmm. I have similar problem with the Stag, so I put a little screen at the bottom. Recently, mm-hmm. I've been using the Espro because the Espro doesn't ever have this problem. Mm-hmm. V60 is good. I think one of the good and the bad of the V60, the plastic mm-hmm. V60 is good for temperature retention. The V60 is good for, like, if you go from, like, 20 grams to 25 grams in a V60, the coffee mm-hmm. bed height doesn't change that much because of the shape. And mm-hmm. so the V60 can be very flexible in terms of using lots of different doses. But mm-hmm. some of the flat bottom brewers are very sensitive to different dose sizes because your bed height might end up being too shallow or too deep too mm-hmm. easily. So, for instance, mm-hmm. like the Stag and the Espro, you know, if I'm going down to like 20 grams in those, I'm getting more channeling, more astringency because the bed is not very high. So yeah. I might have more success with those with the Kalita or the V60 or something like that. So, you know, in and of themselves, some of the brewers are slightly mm-hmm. better designs than the others. But, you know, if you tend to, say, brew like 25 grams, you know, maybe mm-hmm. the Espro is the brewer for you. If you tend to use lots of different doses, maybe the V60 is the brewer for you. Mm-hmm. So I don't want people to feel like one is so much better than the other. It's mm-hmm. more like it kind of depends on your dose size and how often you change things up.
So is it just a dose or also about the body acidity or the aroma of the cup? I mean, what are your observations on those characteristics between them?
Sure. I don't think, so number one, the body is probably more determined by the filter you use more than anything else, because mm-hmm. the pore size and the amount of pores, et cetera, and how much fines and colloids mm-hmm. they let through is going to have a bigger impact on body than anything else. Doesn't matter which brewer mm-hmm. it is, okay? Acidity shouldn't be too impacted by the brewer either, because that should be driven by your temperature and by your extraction level and your extraction mm-hmm. evenness. Aroma definitely shouldn't be too affected by the brewers because the aromatics are, gaseous dissolved compounds that are pretty much like how aromatic the coffee is and what the aroma is like is going to be determined by the temperature at which you brew and how concentrated the brew is. Mm-hmm. Right. So if you have like a 1.7 TDS, it's going to seem more aromatic than 1.3 TDS just because there's more concentration. Yes. And if you brew at a higher temperature, you'll probably perceive more aromatics because you'll have more of the gases coming out of the solution. Mm-hmm. Okay. So I think, again, it's more about using each of these brewers successfully. Just depends on good physics and good technique. And I promise you, and I would happily bet a lot of money with any coffee professionals that if I were to brew them several brews from different brewers, nobody would be able to successfully guess which brewer the coffee came from, other than just, you know, pure random luck.
That's great. I mean, that's actually what I am trying to understand, you know. Many people think it.
There was a study last year about flat bottom versus cone brewers. And the study was deeply flawed. It was done by scientists, but they really didn't understand the dynamics of brewing and the fact that, for instance, when they did their experiments, they did not control for bed heights. They didn't control well for extraction level. They didn't really control for shit, to be honest. Like, they did a terrible job. And then a lot of people were like, oh, you know, flat bottom is different than cone. It's really not true. It's really a matter of you need to adjust your technique and your dose, et cetera, to optimize for each brew. Mm-hmm. So, and once you've done that, the difference in quality is very trivial.
Yeah, well said. So it's clearly understood now. I mean, it depends on the barista's technique, so you can get the same results with every brewer. Sure. Okay, so another one. Is it a meat question? So use low PPM water for light roast, higher PPM water for darker roast. Is it a meat or correct?
Okay, so I don't agree with this personally, but I also don't want to tell people what their coffee should taste like. So first of all, people in coffee usually refer to the PPM or the TDS, but really they should be focused more on alkalinity. Because if you had to focus on one thing, and I don't think you should focus on just one thing, but if you did, alkalinity would be number one. Because alkalinity is the main driver of how much acidity or flatness, et cetera, your coffee has. That's number one. Number two, now, if your alkalinity is lower, you're going to have coffee that's a little bit more acidic, a little bit brighter. Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, if you have a light roast, you already have a coffee that is lighter, more acidic. Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, it would seem logical to potentially use higher alkalinity water for lighter roasts to tone down the acidity, and maybe lower alkalinity water for darker roasts to enhance the acidity. But let's face it, I don't know what your goals are. Maybe you're someone who just loves extremely bright, extremely acidic coffee. And so for you, the best result is a light roast with low alkalinity water, because that's all you care about is more acidity, right?
Acidity.
So I think all that really matters is not to tell people, oh, you should change your water chemistry based on your roast, blah, blah, blah. It's more like you have a coffee, you taste the coffee. If you want more acidity or more brightness, you could try lower alkalinity water. And that would enhance that. Or if you want to tone it down, you'd use higher alkalinity water. I don't want to go around telling people that, you know, there's a perfect water per coffee roast, because I don't know what you want.
Okay, so it's fair enough. I mean, so it depends on what you like and which characteristic you like in the cup. So that's well said. So another water question. So, I mean, what are your thoughts on the pig water? Jack, so many people ask for it. I mean, is it a lifesaver for the home baristas? Because you already said, you know, alkalinity is number one to check when using a water. So, I mean, then, you know, how is pig water? You also use it.
Sure. I don't generally talk about products, but I am interested in talking about this because I think it's interesting and innovative. The pig is great for some people and not as important for other people. So the peak won't increase your alkalinity, of course. It'll decrease it. And what's clever about the peak is that there are different settings on it so that you can use a bypass within the filter so that the amount you decrease the alkalinity is controllable. Mm-hmm. Okay? So if you have very hard water with very high alkalinity, you may be able to use the peak to dial your water chemistry down to something that's perfect for coffee. And it'll be an easier and cheaper solution than buying bottled water, and less wasteful also. Now, if you already have very soft water at home, there's nothing wrong with using the peak, but the peak won't give you like a special new result. Okay? So let's mm-hmm. say you have alkalinity, like okay, my tap water at home has something like hardness of 175 ppm and alkalinity of like 120 ppm, okay. right? So I can use the peak and I can dial my alkalinity down to like 40 to 50, and that's pretty good. And mm-hmm. it tastes really good, and I don't have to go out and keep buying bottled water and wasting plastic and all that kind of thing. And it's mm-hmm. a lot more convenient to just keep refilling the peak all the time. Mm-hmm. So in my case, I'm very lucky that the peak is useful for my water at home.
Okay, thank you. So you also have a small chapter in your book, Professional Handbook for Baristas, but it's a very small chapter, and I think we may refer to Water for Coffee. Mm-hmm. Book, right, for that one. And another water question, maybe this is just a yes or no question. So is it a waste of time to use water that does not meet the values recommended by SCA?
I'm sorry, say the question one more time.
So, I mean, if the water does not meet the values recommended by the okay. SCA, uh-huh. so is it a waste of time to use that water?
No. I think it's like this. The SCA standards for water are fine. Mm-hmm. But going back to our last discussion before the peak, I don't know what you want from your coffee. And mm-hmm. there may be times where you want a little more alkalinity, a little less alkalinity, et cetera. And mm-hmm. I don't think you are stuck in the SCA range to make good coffee. I think you can adjust. Mm-hmm. Probably the optimal water is slightly more flexible than the SCA range. But you know, so I don't want to worry about that too much. It's more like
okay.
there are some guidelines out there. There's the guidelines in the Water for Coffee book. There's guidelines that SCA puts out. There's guidelines that Barista Hustle has put out. There's guidelines in my book. They're all actually mm-hmm. relatively similar with slight shifts in the alkalinity and TDS. And, mm-hmm. You know, they're all reasonable, and you really just have to find what's working with your coffee and your taste.
Okay, thank you. So
I'm going to add one thing. I'm sorry to interrupt.
Yeah, sure.
The one thing we haven't discussed in all this water conversation is that you can't necessarily, or you shouldn't necessarily, just use any old water that tastes good to you with coffee, because some water you might enjoy for coffee will create scale in your machines, and you don't want that. So, for instance...
Okay.
Especially with espresso, sometimes extremely high TDS, extremely high alkalinity water can taste great mm-hmm. with espresso because the acidity in espresso is so concentrated, so it kind of balances mm-hmm. out, but that water could be destroying your machine. So, mm-hmm. Of course, if you're making a pour-over, it's no big deal. You get a little scale in your pitcher. You can descale it with some vinegar one day. But when it comes to espresso machines and batch brewers, you want mm-hmm. to use something called the Langelier Saturation mm-hmm. Index. And you can look this up online, and you can plug in all of your water chemistry numbers, and it will tell you if it will create scale and how fast mm-hmm. it will create scale. And you mm-hmm. need to know that. If you have a cafe, you need to know that about your water before you commit to using a certain water and water treatment, or else you could be ruining mm-hmm. your machines.
Yep. Okay, good point. All so right. Now I will get into the roasting and the coffee bean questions. Okay. So, I mean, some coffees lose their aroma, pretty quickly, like within 15-20 days after roasting. I mean, is it something related to the roasting profile, or is it related mostly with the variety of the coffee bean?
Okay. I'm going to assume that when people say that the aroma is disappearing quickly, that by far, the number one factor is... Oh, by the way, somebody just asked, can I repeat the tool name? It's the Langelier Saturation Index, Langelier Saturation Index. You can Google that, and it's like a water chemistry scale production calculator. Okay, sorry.
Thank you, Scott.
So the biggest factor in whether the coffee is going to change or lose aroma quickly is how dark you roasted it and how much damage you did to the bean's cellulose structure. Mm-hmm. That's by far number one. Like when it comes to variety or how you roasted it or other things like storage conditions, they all might matter. But really, mm-hmm. darker roasts, the cellulose breaks down more, and then the gases and the aromatics leave mm-hmm. much faster. And so you will lose aroma much more quickly, and you might also have rancidity set in more quickly because of exposed oils and broken down cellulose. So I don't think variety matters too much in this discussion. Of course, storage conditions matter. For instance, if your roasted coffee is sitting at 20°C, it will age slowly. If it's sitting at 30°C, it'll age pretty quickly. And it'll start tasting and smelling funky pretty quickly. If you freeze it, it'll in a vac sealed container, it'll last like 10 years. It'll still smell great when you finally use it. So those are, I think, the big considerations is how dark and then what the storage temperature is.
Okay, thank you. So maybe another one that may be also related to that one. I mean, do you think roasters can achieve good results with past crop coffee?
Okay, so... look, everybody has different taste and much of the world, you know, I'm sure we all have parents and other people in our lives who kind of like old, low quality, dark coffee. Right.
Yes.
And you know, I mean, you look in Turkey, I mean, you know, traditional coffee is pretty dark, made in an Ebrik, and that's fine, but it may not be what you and I enjoy, you know, or may not meet the quality standards of today's specialty industry. Right. Mm-hmm. So now I've totally lost the question now that we started.
That's okay. I mean, actually, the reason is, I got this question from a few roasters. You know, green coffee prices are higher. Mm-hmm. So sometimes they prefer, you know, old crops. And they buy old crops for cheaper, you know. Is it possible to achieve good results with the old crop coffee? And what are the differences on the cup between a fresh crop and the old crop? So that's the question.
I mean, the simple answer is no, like not really, because, you know, the quality of the ingredients you put in cannot be improved upon, right? Like when it comes to coffee, one way to look at coffee is you start out at this level. You have a 85-point coffee, right? And it's fresh. It only gets worse from there. It can never become an 88-point coffee, right? Maybe you ruin quality in the roasting. Maybe you ruin quality in storage. Maybe you ruin the quality in the brewing, right? If the green coffee is already faded and aged, it can only be so good. So I'm not here to tell you what you should like, but let's face it. If you buy cheaper aged coffee, it's cheaper for a reason. And I think most people are they're doing it out of financial motivation, and maybe they're trying to convince themselves that the quality is a little better than it really is, but... Mm-hmm. Yeah, I, you know, yeah.
Okay, the short answer is
no. The short answer is no.
Yeah, okay. So we now, know the answer now. So another roasting question. So I also got this question from several people. So this may be one of your favorites or not.
Okay, all right, okay.
So in your social media, I will read that one because I'm not an expert, just a home barista. So in your social media, we often see questions regarding to baked coffee.
Okay.
So, if I'm not wrong, a quick decrease after first crack is classified as baked in your terms. Mm-hmm. So according to Nordic roasting approach, roasters decrease ROR really fast after first crack in order to obtain all color spectrums into the bean to have the richest result. So is it also possible that ROR stall is a reason of water evaporation, and why sometimes ROR flick doesn't develop baking flavors?
Okay, so that's a lot of questions in one.
We may keep it simple.
Okay. So I think these are the important points in this discussion.
Yeah.
First of all, I think there's a lot of assumptions about what quote unquote Nordic roasting is.
Yes,
and I've you know, if you spend time in the Nordic countries, it's not so simple. I think if I had to make a generalization about Nordic roasting, because, you know, people who roast extremely light and what's popular in that part of the world, it's not necessarily that the ROR always drops so fast after first crack. It has more to do with hitting first crack at a pretty high ROR so that you create more pressure in the bean, so that you penetrate the bean a little bit better, and that you get a little bit more development at a very light roast. So I think that's the important thing. Now, whether it crashes or not after that is a different story. If you've read my new book about roasting, you'll see that I talk a little bit about how, you know, while ROR crashes create baked coffee, the later in the roast the crash is, the less baked it'll taste. So yes. If you, for instance, have a crash that happens at first crack, and then you roast another 10C after that at a very low ROR, it's going to taste very baked. If you smash into first crack at a high ROR, and then it's like the very last 5 seconds of the roast, it starts to crash, it's not going to taste nearly as baked as something that crashed earlier. So, you know, I just don't want to assume too much about the quote-unquote Nordic roasts, because I think that there's I've heard the opposite. Like, I've read people say something like, oh, you know, Nordic roasters have very, very low ROR's at first crack and blah, blah, blah. And it's like, that's not true either. It's you know, but simply put, if you want to roast extremely light, you're going to need to hit first crack at a higher ROR to generate more development relative to roast color. Now, whether you like that, whether it tastes good, whether what you consider is developed is what I consider developed, those are all subjective questions, you know. I don't know. The question about the full spectrum of colors, et cetera, like, it's too much to go into here. I don't think that's an accurate representation, because I think that's what we all want, whether we know it or not, it, to some degree, is we want to make sure that the bean centers are developed to a certain degree that suits us personally. And that doesn't necessarily mean like a variety of colors within the bean. Like, you might like an extremely light roast where the bean is is like kind of even throughout, you know.
Okay.
So, yeah.
So most of our listeners are being home baristas, so I think that scale is enough for them. Maybe I'm just reading the comments that some of them are Turkish. So so another question about I saw your chat with Lucia Solis, so it was a great session. So how do you approach experimental fermentation techniques and origin, and what adjustments are needed to roast those coffees, or if any, you know?
Do you know what time you began with your friend on this discussion?
Which one?
Oh, I'm asking, I want to answer the question, but what time did you begin the live chat? Because we have 1 hour before Instagram cuts us off.
Actually, it's not 1 hour now. I mean, they extended that one.
Okay. Sorry. I thought I was like, okay, this is a long answer. I don't want to run out of time. Okay.
So,
Okay.
I mean, so, if you are available, I mean, it would be great for us to have.
No problem. Yeah, okay. That's great. I have the whole pandemic to talk. It's okay.
Okay.
So I want to be careful about this answer. There are so many different processing variations and experiments going on. I don't want to make too many assumptions or say something that's not true for all kinds. Okay. But I think that most roasters are focusing in the wrong place if they obsess over roasting differently for different types of processing. Okay. What I'd like roasters to focus more on is how do we apply heat to the beans in such a way that the coffees will develop efficiently and evenly, okay? And I don't care whether it's a natural or a washed coffee or some anaerobic fermentation or whatever. What really matters is how big are the beans, how much moisture do they have, and how strong is the cell structure of the beans? So like at the extreme, for example, you have a very weak cell structure in decaf, because the decaffeination process weakens the beans. So you don't need as much heat to develop decaf well. Okay. Another example is you always need more gas to roast like a Pacamara or Margogipe relative to a very small bean like most Ethiopians or pea berries. Because the very large bean size, it's a little bit like putting if you were to put a large loaf of bread and a small loaf of bread in the oven at the same time, of course the small loaf of bread is going to cook much faster with the same amount of heat applied. Okay. And then also you have a situation of how much moisture the bean has, because the more moisture that comes out of the bean, the harder it is to get the heat to penetrate the bean, because the moisture coming out acts as a little bit of like a buffer that prevents the heat from getting to the bean surface as easily. Okay. So regardless of the fermentation technique, the processing technique, those are really the big things, is how big is the bean, how much moisture does the bean have, and how strong is the cell structure. I think that in this equation, that processing is not that important, but I think that people often make a lot of assumptions based on limited experience. So for instance, It's tempting to say that naturals need less gas at first crack because sometimes it's more common with naturals to see the ROR sort of like take off with a certain amount of heat application that won't necessarily take off that way in like a dense high-grown washed coffee. But but I think that consideration is overdone. I think just, you know, if people will focus on the bean size, the moisture content, and how hard and strong the cell structure is, that's like well over 90% of the equation about how much heat to apply, and everything else is trivia.
Okay. Thank you. And actually, you know, when we talk about naturals, I know you're not a big fan of natural processed coffees, right?
right.
So should I ask that question?
Yeah, sure. I mean, look, there are some very good naturals out there.
Yeah.
My two concerns about naturals, it's nothing to do with my personal taste. Number one is that most naturals, I think that they are graded too generously in terms of cleanliness and cup score, right? Mm-hmm. So in other words, I see all these people saying that these naturals are 90-point coffees. And if you were grading them based on their cleanliness relative to very good washed coffees, I think that the naturals are being graded too generously. And I'm not saying that because I don't personally enjoy naturals too much. I just think that there's like a unfairness in the system. Then, of course, you know, with a lot of naturals that aren't like elite, awesome ones, there is like a fermenty flavor that some people enjoy. I just don't enjoy that flavor in coffee. And so, you know, to each his own, of course. But I like this morning, actually, I drank, I'm starting a new project with my friend Ryan Brown, who wrote the book Dear Coffee Buyer, which is like by far the best book about green coffee buying. It's so good. And he has been sampling many, many coffees for our project. And one of, if not our favorite coffee for the first month of this project is a natural. Actually, we were both very surprised. And this morning, actually, I drank some of it. It was a natural Yirgacheffe. And it's super clean. It doesn't have any of that fermentiness. And I really enjoyed it. And so I'm not necessarily anti-natural. I just think that if people are honest about the cleanliness and all that, like, you know, but... they can be great, you know.
Okay, fair enough. So another question on espresso and your, you know, high extraction espresso technique where you use, you know, two filters, one at the bottom of the basket and one on the top of the puck. So we got this question from our brewery champion, Turkey brewery champion, Orkun. So he asks, you know, I mean, what effects we have when you have two filters, you know, one in the bottom, one on the top. What are the impacts? I mean, what's the scientific impact behind this?
Okay. So I call this the filter sandwich, right?
Yeah,
and filter sandwich. So a long time ago, I didn't invent this idea of putting a bottom filter. The bottom filter was something that was on coffee forums like 15 years ago. And but then I got the idea a few years ago of putting a top filter on. And I think it's like this. The bottom filter... Think about this. When you look at the porter filter basket bottom, there's a certain amount of hole area, but the hole area doesn't go to the very edge of the basket bottom, right? And actually, it's funny because Jonathan was just talking about this extensively with me this past weekend. And we know that the bottom filter helps the coffee flow faster. And it seems that it makes the extraction a little bit more even because it doesn't allow the water to pass through the middle preferentially. And it seems like, imagine this. Instead of the liquid having to force its way through the holes that aren't all the way to the edge of the basket, having the filter that covers the whole bottom of the basket acts like there are holes everywhere in the basket. So it gives more surface for the liquid to pass through. So it creates... more flow and more even flow through the coffee bed. Okay. And of course, you know, if you've tried the filter on the bottom, you know you can grind finer with the filter on the bottom and you can get a higher extraction, and that makes sense.
Yeah.
Now, the point of the top filter is that instead of the liquid, you know, if you look at the way the liquid comes out of your espresso shower head, it's not always perfect spray, right? Like, I mean, we have like a perfectly clean, fresh new shower head. It looks perfect. But then like a day later, it looks like the stream kind of coalesces into the center or something like that. It's very possible that when you don't have the filter on the top, that whatever mm-hmm. areas get wet first from the shower head mm-hmm. are going to attract the most water flow because they offer yeah. the least resistance to the water flow. So the filter on the top for some people may help make the liquid pool up on top of the filter before it starts passing through the coffee bed more mm-hmm. evenly. So especially if your puck prep isn't that good, that top mm-hmm. filter is going to decrease channeling and make your extraction more even. If you have yeah, amazing right. puck prep, maybe the top filter won't help you as much.
Okay.
But the combination of top and bottom filter gives you higher extraction, more even extraction, and less channeling in mm-hmm. general.
Okay, so what about the body of that espresso? Because you are using a filter paper, mm-hmm. so it will keep some of the oils. So yeah, what about the test?
That's certainly possible. You know, I don't express a strong opinion about this. Again, we're back to this body versus flavor clarity. Yes. If you are correct that the bottom filter is decreasing the body, then by definition, mm-hmm. it's increasing the flavor clarity. So... Yeah. I'm always happy with that personally. Like I want clean, clear flavors in my coffee. Body is nice, but I think the longer you spend in the coffee industry, the more you focus on the flavor clarity and you worry less about body.
Yes.
But I think like a lot of consumers are more attracted to the body because they're not very sensitive to the flavor, you know, the interesting flavors of coffee. So, again, it's a trade-off like everything in coffee mm-hmm. and the bottom filter will, probably clarify the brew a little bit for you mm-hmm. as well as helping the evenness of the flow through the coffee bed.
Yeah, thanks so much, Scott. So now the next question is about our culture, Turkish coffee.
Okay.
So do you brew and drink Turkish coffee or, I mean, are you familiar with it at least, you know?
I'm a little bit familiar with it. I'll confess that I have very little experience with it. Mm-hmm. I suspect that I read a lot of things people say about, oh, this is how you do it, this is how you do it. Mm-hmm. I suspect I've probably not really had it made that well. It's yep. possible. I did go to a cafe once that had the hot sand, like that, mm-hmm. I don't know what you call it, where they kept the Ebrick in the hot sand mm-hmm. on the bar, and they made it what seemed like kind of the proper way, and it was pretty good. Mm-hmm. You know, but... I've never owned an Ebrick. I've never like put one on a stove or something like that. Mm-hmm. My impression is that most people probably make it badly because they boil mm-hmm. the concoction and maybe make it a little bit more acrid. But mm-hmm. maybe for some people, like I think if they're making it with sugar, maybe that's changing the mm-hmm. dynamic. Maybe that acrid flavor isn't that bad. But I confess I'm not an expert in it. I'm not very experienced with it. So I don't really have a strong opinion about it.
Okay. Thank you. So, another question on the immersion method. So, I mean, if you home barista asked me to ask this question to you. So what are your thoughts on the equipments that use immersion technique and when they are superior to percolation methods?
So, okay, the main difference between immersion and percolation is that mm-hmm. with percolation, you're always adding fresh water and removing strong coffee concentrate. So mm-hmm. the percolation will... generally achieve a higher extraction. Mm-hmm. But percolation always has the risk of channels. And yes. channels can create a bitterness and astringency, and that's not pleasant. So you're safer with immersion in terms of avoiding astringency and bitterness. And certainly for something like roasting quality control or buying green coffee, you should always use cupping. You should always use the immersion because it's foolproof. It's very hard to ruin it. It's very mm-hmm. safe. It's very repeatable. Whereas percolation always takes some skill and maybe some luck to get it just right, you know. Mm-hmm. But, you know, if you're going to use immersion, you don't need anything special. Like, for instance, when I go on an airplane, mm-hmm. a lot of times what I'll do is I'll just pre-grind a little bit of coffee, put it in a little Ziploc bag. I'll ask mm-hmm. for hot water and I'll just pour it in there and make like a cupping, let the ground settle to the yep. bottom and just drink it and not get to the sludge. And it's good. Like, it works.
Great solution.
Quite well. Yeah. And so, like, immersion is very easy to do well. You don't need anything special at all. Mm-hmm. If you use a French press, you might want to use the cupping version of the French press where you kind of scoop the stuff off the top rather than plunging the French press. Because if you plunge it, you stir up a lot of fines and oils. Mm-hmm. And that's fine if you want a lot of body, but you get a very cloudy flavor.
Yeah, okay, thank you. By the way, if you are writing below in Turkish, they say, you know, instead of ibrik, we say cezve.
Okay.
So I think it's also in the championships, they call it cezve ibrik championship.
Okay.
So,
okay. Yeah. Sorry about that. Well, you know, when I come back to Turkey, you can make it for me and teach me about it.
Yeah, of course. I mean, you're always welcome. I mean, if you ever come to Turkey, we can also give you one gift, you know, a nice cezve, and we can drink together. I hope so.
Sounds good.
Yeah. So, next question. So this is also becoming very, very popular recently, and I also saw it on the Jonathan Gagne's chat. So what do you think about storing vacuum-sealed coffees in the freezer?
Oh, I mean, it's great in the sense that it works quite well. Your coffee will stay fresh for many years.
Yeah.
And that way you always have a variety of good coffees to choose from. You don't, you know, have to run out. You know, I could see like some people won't like it because it's if you're using disposable bags or something, that could be a little bit wasteful. So maybe if you get little containers, tiny vacuum containers, that would be amazing.
Yeah.
But as far as quality goes, it's fantastic. It'll preserve your coffee very well. And like, so, you know, right now I have like, I don't have a ton of space in my freezer, but I have like 10 coffees. When I get a good coffee, I'll put a couple of doses in the freezer just so that if I ever want to go back to it, I can. And that's always fun, you know?
So what's your best practice? I mean, okay, you dose the vacuum sealed bags and put it in the freezer. So, I mean, do you dose a single dose or multiple dose? And when you put it out from the freezer, what's your best practice? How long do you wait? When do you grind them?
I think best practice is to do one dose at a time because if you have like a bunch of doses and then you open up the container, you're going to introduce some moist, warm air into it. And that's going to cause condensation. That's going to change the flavor when you refreeze it and then, you know, defrost it, that kind of thing. So I think, you know, do single doses. And when you're ready to use it, this is a little bit controversial, but I think when you're ready to use it, have everything ready, grind it and brew it right away. Don't let it sit at room temperature. Don't let it get condensation. I can't guarantee that the condensation would be bad, but I think it's much safer and wiser to just throw it in the grinder, grind it, brew it as quickly as possible. Just avoid any risks. Yeah.
Because there are also other opinions, you know, that they just, you know, let the coffee sit on the table till it gets to the room temperature grind. So, yes.
So you can definitely do that as long as you don't open the container. Like I used to do it like this. Mm-hmm. Like I used to take out a portion at night and then in the morning when I would, cause I only drink coffee in the morning, then in the morning I would just, now it's room temperature. Now I would take it out and grind it. And that works fantastic. If you have the time and if you think ahead and plan ahead, you can definitely do it that way. But I think it's fine to grind frozen beans. But you know, if you think ahead and you want to pre-warm them, you know, and before you open up the package, that's great, you know?
Okay. So actually we already had 1 hour. So if you have 5 more minutes, I have just 2 more questions.
Let's do one more question because actually I have to go relatively soon.
Okay. So. Yeah, sure. Actually this is, on the impact of COVID-19, you know, COVID-19 completely changed the coffee consumption habits. So what do you think about the impact of the pandemic on the coffee industry and what should we expect in 2021?
It's my least favorite kind of question because I think when you try to predict the future, you always look silly, you know? I'm definitely not an expert on what's going on in the industry right now. It's very sad that the industry is so bad for restaurants and cafes. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I mean, who knows if life will go back to the way it was? Who knows if we'll always be a little bit cautious about COVID? Who knows how many cafes will close? Who knows if the cafes that survived are going to be extremely busy because there's less competition for a while? I'm sorry. I have no idea. It's just a very, it's a very hard situation, of course. And, you know, hopefully people are surviving that when life goes back to normal, everything will be okay. But
Okay. Thank you so much. Yeah. So Scott, I think this wraps up our chat and we are really thankful. And I think our listeners are also very thankful for sure. So it was amazing to have you here as our guest and we learned a lot from you. It was a great guide now. So I don't know how to thank you, Scott. So it's really a great honor for us. And
those were great questions. And thank you for everyone for tuning in. And good luck with getting through the rest of the pandemic. And hopefully we will meet in person soon.
Yeah, I hope to drink a cup of tea or sencha tea. Sencha tea. Yeah, right?
Yes, you love sencha.
Okay, maybe sencha or coffee with you one day. So thanks so much, Scott.
Okay.
Thank you for being our guest. Take care.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Geldim. Türkçe olarak geldim. Hiç anlayabilirsin. Evet, harika bir yayın oldu. Harika. Teşekkür ederiz Levent. Ağzına sağlık, eline sağlık. Müthişti her şey. Alkışlar. Gönderiyorum sana.
Teşekkürler. Umarım faydalı bir yayın olmuştur. Ben tabii İngilizce devam etmeye şey yaptım.
Harikaydı. Gerçekten harikaydı. Levent, çok teşekkür ederiz ya. Vallahi müthiş bir yemek. Eline yüreğine sağlık. Emeğine sağlık. Rahude çok teşekkür ediyoruz. Sağ olsun geldi. Evet. Bizleri kırmadı. Yayınımıza geldi. Kahve masası bugün. Gerçekten çok özel bir konuğunu ağırladı.
Bizim için bir milat.
Vallahi çok mutluyuz ya. Gerçekten yorumlar harikaydı. Yani yazılanlar, verilen destek.
Ben yazılanların hiçbirini okuyamadım İsmail. Sen bana söylersin. Ben çöp göremedim. Sadece cezve ibrik konusunu gördüm. Onda da çekine çekine söyledim. Çok kişi yazdı. Cezve ibrik diye.
Vallahi sağ olsun. Herkes buradaydı. Değerli dostlarımız da buradaydı. Bu arada Arzum Yönetim Kurulu Başkanı Sayın Murat Kolbaşı da buradaydı. Teşekkür ederiz kendilerine. Desteklerinden dolayı.
Çok sağ olun Murat.
Kendisine bir sorusu oldu. Ben sana ilettim ama yayında göremedim maalesef. Çok teşekkür ederiz.
Yayında alttan çok yazı vardı. Göremedim. Bir yandan da ara sıra bakmak zorunda kalıyordum. Kaymadı otomatik. O yüzden göremedim. Kusura bakmayın sorularınızı, yorumlarınızı. Ben çoğunu göremedim. Özür dilerim.
Çok teşekkür ederiz ya. Harika. Yani gelen yorumlar, Cihan abi teşekkür ederiz. Yani hem Orkun çok teşekkürler. Değerli dostlar, arkadaşlar hepinize çok teşekkür ederiz. Yayına geldiğiniz için, bizleri yalnız bırakmadığınız için, destek verdiğiniz için süperdi. Bence harika bir yayın oldu.
Ya umarım hemen hemen tüm soruların üstünden de gittik. Yani soramadığım soru kalmadı gibi bir şey. Hepsini sorduk. Sağ olsun o da bir saat yani 60-65 dakika bizimle kaldı. Umarım faydalı olmuştur, net olmuştur. Dediğim gibi sürçülisan ettiysek affola. Bazen heyecan, bazen de kelimeleri böyle tam bulamama. Scott Roy ile konuşurken normal bir durum sanırım.
Vallahi
gerçekten
süper ya,
zor bir yayında.
Harika bir yayında.
Ama çok güzel cevaplar verdi. Yani kitap gibi bilgiler en azından ben aldım. Umarım dinleyenler de almıştır.
Çok teşekkürler herkese. Ellerinize sağlık demişler. Bu arada yayınımız Türkçe altyazılı olarak daha sonra Kahve Masası YouTube kanalında olacak. Bir an önce orayı da eklemeye çalışacağız. Yorumlarınız için teşekkür ederiz. Orayı da abone olarak...
Levent abi İngilizce konuşuyor, anlamıyoruz falan yazmışlar.
Bu arada YouTube kanalımıza abone olarak bizleri destekleyebilirsiniz. Bu tarz yayınlarımız devam edecek. Yeni sürprizlerimiz de var. Uğraşıyoruz, çabalıyoruz. Bununla müjdesini vereyim. Vallahi süperdi. Yani ben söyleyecekse söylemiyorum ya, ben hani sen konuşurken ben burada daha çok heyecanlandım. Bir yandan yayın takip ediyorum, bir yandan yazılanlar da arkadaşlar burada keyifli dakikalar geçirdik gerçekten. Güzel yorumlar da oldu. Vallahi süperdi ya Levent. Sırada kim var Levent?
Ya evet. Vallahi bilmiyorum Suat. Yani sanırım artık dediğim gibi bilemiyorum. Öyle şey heyecandan. Ya umarım keyifli bir yayın olmuştur. Ben çok yayın heyecanıyla da çünkü anlamadım. Yani umarım anlaşılırdır gerçekten. Herkes sorduğu soruların cevabını almıştır. Ben bayağı bir şey öğrendim çünkü epey güzel bilgiler de verdi. Özellikle yani su konusunda, işte eski hasat, yeni hasat konusunda, espresso konusunda yani dolu dolu öğrenemeyeceğimiz bilgiler aldık. Yani bunu da zaten Türkçe altyazısını yaptığımızda da göreceğiz. Tekrardan biz üstünden gideceğiz. Dediğim gibi sorularını soramadıklarım varsa da kusura bakmasın lütfen. Zamanın çoğunu doldurduk zaten. Olabildiğince soruları birleştirip sormaya çalıştım. Kendimizi bile tanıtamadım. Aslında İsmail'le de konuşmuştuk yayın başında. Hani kendimizden bahsedelim, işte kulüpten bahsedelim vesaire diye ama hani ne ben kendimi tanıtabildim, ne olduğumu, ismimi söyleyebildim, ne İsmail'i tanıtabildim.
Gayet güzel.
Hiçbir şey söyleyemedim. Adımızı bize söylemeden geçti. Kusura bakmayın lütfen.
Tetsu Kasuya denmiş. Neden olmasın?
Neden olmasın?
Şimdilik sadece bu kadar diyorum. Neden olmasın? Hoffman denmiş. Neden olmasın?
Yani neden olsun? Diye.
Yani valla sizlerin, şunu söylemek gerekiyor. Gerçekten sizlerin verdiği desteklerle bizler de kendilerine ulaşıyoruz. Yani yayınımıza gelen biliyorsun Levent, yani şeyden Box yayından beri gerçekten arkadaşlarımız da çok ciddi, hani bütün yayınlarımız öyleydi. Hani 5-10 kişi başladık. Kesinlikle. Yayınlara, konuşmaya başladık. Box yayınında en son Onur'un yayında yaklaşık 80 online izleyicimiz oldu. Bugün gerçekten 170-180'e kadar çıktık. Harika, yani süper. Biz her perşembe saat 21'de kahve masası programında buradayız. Sizlerden gelen soruları, içtiğimiz kahveleri konuşmaya devam ediyoruz. Elimizden geldiğince, dilimizin döndüğünce tecrübelerimizi paylaşmaya, kahve tecrübelerimizi paylaşmaya, ekipman tecrübelerimizi paylaşmaya devam ediyoruz. Bunları da tüm samimiyetimizle doğrudan sizlere iletmeye çalışıyoruz. Bunu da farkınızda, hani bize gönderdiğiniz bildirimlerden, geri bildirimlerden, sorulardan görüyoruz. Sizlerin denediklerini bizler de deniyoruz. Kahve olarak, ekipman olarak bunları daha çok kişiye, daha çok dostumuza, evet, arkadaşımıza, hobi olarak bunları iletmeye devam edeceğiz. Bunu da böyle buradan söyleyeyim. Bize de destek olmak isteyen çok arkadaşımız oluyor. Desteğinizi tek sahip yapmanız gereken Instagram'da TYR'den kahve ve web kahve hesaplarını takip etmek. Yine YouTube'da Kahve Masası kanalına abone olmak. Bunun ayrıca sizden bir şey istemiyoruz. Yayınlarımıza da geldiğiniz için çok teşekkür ederiz. Harikaydı. Gerçekten her şey süperdi. Levent, evet, sen neler söylemek istersin?
Dediğim gibi herkese çok teşekkür ediyorum. Yani Scott Rowe'yu yani yazıştık, konuştuk. Bir türlü herhalde frekanslar tuttu. O da sağ olsun gelmeyi kabul etti. Ardından bayağı bir yazıştık. Yani şartları konuştuk vesaire, işte sorularımızı paylaştık derken gelmeyi kabul etti. Güzel bir yayın oldu. Yani çok güzel de yorumlar aldık. Çok güzel geri bildirimler de aldık. Yani Türkiye'de daha önceden yapılmamış bir şeydi. Bu da bize nasip oldu gibi bir şey oldu. Yani evet, o yüzden çok mutluyuz gerçekten. Hani ufak da bir topluluk olsak aslında baktığınızda demek ki büyük yerlere ulaşabiliyoruz bazen samimiyetimizle ya da öğrenme isteğimizle. Yani o yönden de birazcık cesaret verici oldu. Umarım devamı gelir. Yani Türkiye'den de zaten çok değerli kahve sektöründen kahve profesyonelleri var. Onları da almaya devam edeceğiz zaten. Belki bu tarz özel konuklarda umarım olabilir. Dediğim gibi çok kolay bir şey değildi. Hani bu Scott Rowe oldu şimdi, hani çıta böyle hani yükseğe çıktı, işte haftaya yok Hoffman sonra Kasuya gibi bir şey yok yani. Hani öyle bir şey kesinlikle yok.
Ya bunlar
yok.
Yani sizlerin
de espri, hani kendi aramızda söylüyoruz.
Yani gerçekten sizlere de... Deniz abi dediği gibi iyi bir referans oldu. Evet, yani biz Scott Rowe sayesinde, bu yayın sayesinde daha çok kişiye ulaştığımızı düşünüyorum. Hani bu yayın YouTube'da daha sonra çok fazla izlenecek. Ya, yani Türkiye'de nitelikli kahve sektörüyle ilgili bir şeyler yapıldığı, bir şeyler olduğu, bir şeyler üretildiği konusunda ben bir noktaya geldiğimize inanıyorum. Hani en azından bir şeyler yani olduğunu söylüyoruz.
Ya, hem referans
bizim
oldu.
Söyleyecek bir şeyimiz var. Hani sadece Türk kahvesi değil. Onu söylemek istiyorum ben. Hani
evet, hem referans oldu İsmail bu, hem de zaten hani güzel sorular gitti. Büyük ihtimalle hani Scott Rowe da sorulardan memnun kalmış olabilir. Bazıları tabii genelde, ama hani yine çok kaliteli sorular vardı. Güzel bir ilgi vardı. Yani en azından bunu göstermek bile güzel bir şey. Çünkü bu insanlara ulaşmak gerçekten zor. Hani onların ağzından çıkan şeyler hemen kabul görüyor zaten. Çok farklı şeyler söylüyorlar. Gördünüz işte, yani hani biz bazen kendi aramızda tartışıyoruz, konuşuyoruz işte. Hani doğal işlenmiş kahvedir, sudur vesaire. Yani çoğu damak tadı diyor. Yani işte hani düşük ppm suyla işte light roast mu işte demlemek lazım diyoruz. Yok diyor. Yani sen seviyorsan diyor yüksek ppm suyla dene. Başka suyla dene. Yine de diyor zevk alırsın diyor. Yani hani bazı kalıplar yani kalıplara sokmaya gerek yok diyor kahveyi. O yönden de güzel öğretiler oldu bizim için İsmail.
Kesinlikle. Yani bizler de işte daha çok denememiz gerektiğini görüyoruz bu yayınlardan da. Gerçekten de güzel değil. Yani Levent şu çok değerli bence. Hani biz Türkiye'de hani ikimiz hani bu şekilde işte kahve masası yayını yapıyoruz. Scott Rowe gibi bir isme ulaşıyoruz ve Scott Rowe işte sabahın, hani bizim işi şu anda akşam ama onlar için sabahın o vaktinde kalkıp bizler için yayına gelmesi, yani zaman ayırması gerçekten çok değerli. Yani bu, yani ne kadar profesyonel bir duruş, ne kadar bir profesyonel bir pozisyon olduğunu da gösteriyor. Valla süperdi ya. Gerçekten.
Evet. Çok teşekkür ederiz herkese.
Çok değerliydi. Teşekkür ederiz. Her Perşembe saat 21'de Kahve Masası bilginiz gibi yine burada olacak. Bu hafta Perşembe günü yılbaşı. Belki bir biz genelde 5 dakika diyoruz ama neden yarım saat falan süre bir iyi yıllar deyip hani geleneğimizi bozmayalım diye. Sadece araları böyle özel yayınlarımızı alıyoruz. Bunu da belirtelim. Hani normalde biz yine her Perşembe saat 21'de buradayız. Bu 24. haftadayız. Hani 24 hafta oldu. Vallahi süper. Hani biz bile belki bu kadar devam edeceğini, hani bu kadar böyle şekle devam edeceğimizi düşünmedik ama sizlerin geri bildirimle, destekleriyle daha da ilerliyoruz. Daha da güzel gidiyor. Denizhan abi çok teşekkür ediyorum ya. Gerçekten bizi yayınlarınızı yansıtmadığın için. Evren hocam çok teşekkürler.
Hepiniz de teşekkür ederiz.
Çok teşekkürler. Çok teşekkür ederim. Ebru Hanım, Orkun, yani Orkun, yani vallahi Orkun'a duygu ne diyeceğimi bilmiyorum. Yani herhalde başladığımızdan beri bütün yayınlarda istisnasız var. Hepsinde varlar gerçekten. Kesinlikle. Her yayınımızda varlar. Anıl abi çok teşekkür ederiz. Celsius. Yine Portatif Barista Burak, teşekkür ederiz geldiğiniz için.
Sanırım şimdi İsmail artık bir kahve demleyip içme vakti sanırım. Şöyle bir rahatlayıp vallahi ben de hemen Scott'a yazayım. Bir teşekkür.
Aynen. Yazayım. Teşekkür ederim. Kankine dostuna bir şey teşekkür ederim.
Yok şimdi hemen şey takipten çıkarır beni.
Zafer çok teşekkür ederim. Çok sağ ol.
Yok zaten o şeyi görünce bile çok ilginçti İsmail. Böyle baktım. İşte Scott Rao sizi takip ediyor diye böyle şey geldi. Tamam mı? Mesaj geldi. Dedim ne oluyoruz? Yanlış herhalde bu. Hani bir yerden resim mi geldi?
Aslında çok teşekkür ederiz. Ya. Gerçekten harikasınız. Çok teşekkür ederiz. Yani gelen yorumlar için Onur çok teşekkür ederiz. Herkese teşekkürler. Elinize emeğinize sağlık. Geldiğiniz için çok teşekkür ederiz. Bu arada yeni yılda, yeni yılın ilk haftasında yani 7 Ocak oluyor sanırım. Eğitimle ilgili bir konuğumuz olacak. Bunu da buradan haberini vereyim. Şimdi şey söylemeyeceğim ama çok merak edilen eğitimlerle ilgili, barista eğitimleriyle ilgili özellikle yurt dışına gitmeyi düşünenler çoğunun tercih ettiği eğitimlerle ilgili bir yayınımız olacak. Özel bir güzel bir yayınımız olacak. Bunu da buradan haberini vereyim. 7 Ocak'ta orada görüşeceğiz. Onun öncesinde bu Perşembe yine bir herhalde iyi yıllar.
Kısa bir yılbaşı.
2021 hoş geldi. Artık iyi gel. Ne olur bize iyi gel diyoruz. Bu da ilk adımı olsun. 2020'nin
sezon finali.
Sezon finali.
Premier
çok güzel kapattı gerçekten. 2021'e de öyle çok güzel başlayacağız ve inşallah sağlıklı, zaman güzel, saatli bir
şöyle.
Ben de şöyle.
Şöyle bir raw spin'le yayını.
Ekranı sallayabiliyor muyuz?
Evet.
Levent çok teşekkür ederiz.
Kapatalım mı yayını?
İstiyorsan artık İsmail, sen kapat.
Tamam. İzleyen herkese, gelen herkese çok teşekkür ediyoruz. Bugün kahve masasında konuğumuz dünyanın en etkili kahve profesyonellerinden birkaç tanesinden biri olan Scott Rao'ydu. Sağ olsun kendisinin sabah 9 olmasına rağmen bizimle yayına bu saatte katıldı ve çok güzel bilgiler verdi. Umarım hepiniz memnun kalmışsınızdır. Kahve masası her Perşembe saat akşam 9'da Instagram yayınlarında sizinle. Kahve Masası YouTube kanalında abone olarak da bizi destekleyebilirsiniz. Bu yayını da en yakın zamanda Kahve Masası YouTube kanalına atacağız. Tekrardan çok teşekkürler. Haftaya, ya haftaya değil aslında, Perşembe günü bizi göremezseniz, katılamazsanız şimdiden hepinize iyi yıllar, iyi seneler. Umarım 2021 çok daha güzel olur. Buyur İsmail, son sözü de sana veriyorum.
Oraya da bekliyoruz. Perşembe günü yine 2020'yi artık def etmeye diyelim. 2020 şu pandemi sürecini def etmeye bekliyoruz hepinizi. Tekrardan yayına geldiğiniz için çok teşekkür ederiz. Elinize emeğinize, yüreğinize sağlık. Bize zaman ayırdığınız için çok teşekkür ederiz. Görüşmek üzere. İyi akşamlar.
Sağlıkla kalın. İyi akşamlar.